الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Almighty God, most gracious, most merciful. Dear members of the audience, I find no better greetings to greet you than the universal greetings of peace, Assalamu alaikum, which when translated means, may the peace and blessings of Almighty God be upon us all. We apologize for the delay in starting, but there has been many requests to hold for certain groups of people who have already left and are about to arrive. But unfortunately, we cannot hold on any longer. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you one and all to this important discourse, and we trust that your participation tonight will be fruitful and rewarding. Before we go any further, we begin tonight's discourse with a recitation from the Holy Quran by an aged but beautiful reciter of the Quran, Sayyid Abdul Qadir, who was born in Syria but is presently resident in Cape Town. I call upon Brother Qadir to recite a few verses of the Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد جاءكم رسول من أنفسكم عزيز عليه ما عنتم حريص عليكم بالمؤمنين رؤوف رحيم فإن تولوا فقل حسبي الله لا إله إلا هو عليه توكلت وهو رب العرش العظيم صدق الله العظيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
ما شاء الله. جزاك الله. Thank you. For the benefit of those who are not of the Islamic faith, a reciter is called a hafiz when he has committed to memory every verse of the Holy Quran. This practice by Muslims has resulted in the Quran maintaining its purity as revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, peace be upon him, by Almighty God through the archangel Jibrail. Muslims firmly believe that the Holy Quran is the final word of God Almighty. Brothers and sisters, let me make three preliminary remarks before I call upon our respected speaker. Tonight's address must be understood in its proper perspective. This is not a contest or a debate with Christianity, but it is a sincere attempt to expose and restore to its glory a divinely ordained message for all mankind. One merely has to refer to the following verses of the Quran to understand the seriousness of the obligations and duty on each and every Muslim in this regard. The Quran says, and I can find no better authority than the Quran itself, Surah 41, verse 33. Who is better in speech than one who calls men to God, works righteousness and says, I am of those who bow in Islam? Another surah, Surah 16, verse 125 of the Holy Quran. And invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and discuss with them in ways that are best and most gracious. For thy Lord knows best who have strayed from his path and who receive guidance. Secondly, brothers, the topic in discussion should enlighten us all on the respected, revered, and honorable position which Prophet Jesus, the Arabic terminology, Nabi Isa alayhi salam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, holds in the eyes of Islam and in the eyes of Muslims. The Quran confirms and explains the miracle which surrounds his birth, life, and his most noble ministry. The prophethood of Prophet Jesus, Nabi Isa alayhi salam, is the cornerstone of every Muslim's belief. The myth of a Muslim being anti-Christ should clearly fall away tonight. Finally, we are indeed fortunate to have with us as experienced and as knowledgeable a scholar as Mr. Didat to explore this vital aspect of our belief. Mr. Didat is a well-known personality not only locally but internationally. His early exchanges with preachers and priests from Adam's Mission has turned him into a committed student, scholar, and soldier of Islam. I have pleasure in calling upon Mr. Didat to address you, whereafter you will be free to ask him any question pertinent to the topic. Jazakallah, Mr. Didat.
الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده اللهم يا مفتح الأبواب ويا مسبب الأسباب ويا دليل الحائرين توكلت عليك يا رب العالمين وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, just about 3 months ago, to be exact, on the 5th of June, 1983, on SABC TV, at the end of a lively debate on Islam and Christianity, the chairman, Mr. Bill Chalmers, commented. He said, "I think it can be said from this discussion that there is at present somewhat more accommodation on the Islamic side for the founder of Christianity than on the Christian side for the founder of Islam. What the significance of that is, we leave it to you, the viewer." This was on TV. He's talking to his viewers, some 2 million or more. So we leave it to you, the viewer, to determine. But I do think, Bill Chalmers concluded, but I do think
you will agree that it is a good thing that we are talking together. This was what Bill Chalmers, in his charming manner, said about the attitude of the Muslims on the panel on concluding his program. From the feedback that I have received, I can safely confide in you that more than 90% of his audience, TV audience, who happen to be Christians, they were pleasantly but skeptically surprised. Most of them, they couldn't believe their own ears. They were thinking that perhaps the Muslims were trying to play to the gallery, that they were trying to flatter the Christian fellow countrymen, being situated as we are in this ocean of Christianity, South Africa. We happen to be less than 2% of the population, that we were, so to say, trying to scratch the Christians' back, trying to make them feel good so that they in turn might also say a few good words about our Muhammad. But I can assure you, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, that this was far from the thoughts of the Muslims on the panel. Our Christian fellow countrymen are unaware that Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes it an article of faith for its followers to believe in Jesus. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus. What we believe, we are made to say from the Holy Quran, that we believe that Jesus was one of the mightiest messengers of God. We believe that he was born miraculously, without any male intervention, which many modern-day Christians don't believe today. We believe that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ. And we believe that he gave life to the dead by God's permission, and he healed those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. When I share this with some of our fellow Christian countrymen, they, so to say, are taken aback. They are thinking that we are trying to curry favor with them. But it has to be shown to them that whatever we Muslims say, we are saying this from our holy book, the Holy Quran. In our own language, we never take the name of this mighty messenger of God without saying, Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, means revered Jesus, may peace be upon him. As our chairman did at the beginning, referring to Jesus Christ, he kept on repeating, Hazrat Isa, meaning revered Jesus, or alayhi salam. If our learned men, Muslim learned men, if they speak about this mighty messenger of God, without these respectful terms, if he just said Isa, which means Jesus, the man would be thrown out from his job. Uncouth, barbaric person, taking a name of a mighty messenger of God without these respectable terms. Jesus Christ is mentioned in the Holy Quran by the name Jesus no less than 25 times. Whereas the name Muhammad occurs in this whole vast volume only 5 times. 20 more times Jesus is mentioned by name than the name Muhammad in this volume. He is spoken of as Ibn Maryam, son of Mary, as Masih, the Messiah, Christ, as Rasulullah, the messenger of God, Abdullah, servant of God, as the Spirit of God, as the Word of God, as the sign of God. These are all the respectful terms applied to this mighty messenger. There is not a single statement in this vast volume which one of the most jaundiced of Christians would take exception to. Even the most mentally sick person will never be able to take exception to a single statement made about Jesus in this holy book, the Quran.
The term that is used is Isa.
It is closest to the Afrikaans, Jesus. You see, this was his name. In the original Hebrew, Esau. Classical, Yeshua.
This term, Jesus, is the Latinized form of the Hebrew word Esau.
They Latinized it or Hellenized it by adding a J and an S to his name, which makes it sound something more like Greek or Roman instead of Jewish that it was.
When he was born, he was named by his mother Esau, in Arabic Isa.
Now, we call him the Christ. Jesus is the Christ. We have not another Christ. When the first time this subject was mooted in this very place, over a decade ago, Christ in Islam, there was consternation among the Christian missionaries.
They were thinking that perhaps when I say Christ in Islam, that I might take out of my hat another Christ, or out of my pocket another Christ.
I had to assure them then, as I assure you now, that we have not got another Christ. The Christ in Islam that we are talking about is Jesus Christ.
Some of our people think that the word Christ is synonymous with crucifixion, because the Christian always talks about Christ crucified, Christ crucified. So they think that these two are synonymous terms, Christ meaning crucified. I want to assure them that this is a wrong concept that you have, if you have that. The word Christ has got nothing to do with the word crucifixion, except that this is what the Christian is preaching.
This word Christ comes originally from the Hebrew word Messiah, in Arabic Masih. In Arabic Masih, in Hebrew Messiah, which means anointed. Priests and kings were anointed in consecration to the position as officially appointed. The Greek word for anointed is Christos. From the word Christos, the Christians lopped off the off, os, they cut it off, and they were left with Christ. So it seems like a unique name. Christ seems to be a unique name.
Whereas this was a very common term
among the Jews. If you have your Bibles, I will give you references. In the booklet given to you, you'll find references there. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 45, verse 1, God Almighty is talking about his anointed Cyrus. The word anointed in Greek would be Christos. In Hebrew, it will be Messiah. His Messiah, Cyrus. His Christ, Cyrus. If you can lop off the os in the name of, from Christos to Christ, then the same thing if you do to this word anointed in Greek, in the book of Isaiah, chapter 45, verse 1, you would have Cyrus Christ. And so many references, anointed. You'll find a priest, anointed priest means Christ priest. A pillar was anointed. The word there in Hebrew or Greek would be Messiah pillar, Christ pillar. Christ priest, Christ pots and pans. By God, no exaggeration. Whatever I'm telling you, word for word. There are 100 different places in the Old Testament where you'll find the word anointed, anointed, anointed. In the original, Messiah, Messiah, Messiah. Translated into Greek, Christ, Christ, Christos, Christos, Christos. Now, that does not in any way belittle Jesus Christ. Christ was anointed, means appointed, by God Almighty for his position, his post as a reformer among the Jews.
Now the idea about Christ in Islam comes from Christ in the Quran.
In the Holy Quran, if you open the index, more especially the one I have here with me, the Holy Quran by Abdullah Yusuf Ali, the table that is set outside the Taj Company, they are selling this. The Propagation Center has it. The Islamic Book Center has it. And this book is being, we have a word for it, we say hadiya, but in English I can't help saying that it is being sold for 7 rands 50 cents. A volume of 2,000 pages, there is not another book on earth, an encyclopedia, that you can buy today, 2,000 pages for 7 rands 50. It is available absolutely free to every school, college and university and public library. Every mosque and madrasa free from the Islamic Propagation Center. And if you can't afford it, free to you. You have to write and tell us why we should give you one for nothing. Nobody has an excuse anymore for being without this book. You get this book and open the index right at the back. And in the index, you'll find the subject Jesus and the J on page 1837. Jesus, a righteous prophet. Chapter 6, verse 85. His birth is described in two places. He's apostle to Israel. His disciples, taken up like Adam, not crucified, no more than apostle. Not God, sent with gospel, not son of God, and on and on and on. 15 different chapters in the Quran speak about this mighty messenger of God, Jesus Christ. But for our purpose tonight, let us begin at the beginning. His birth. I open for you, which you can open at home in this book, chapter 3, verse 42. This is how it reads. وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ says, behold, the angel said, O Mary, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاكِ وَطَهَّرَكِ وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ that God Almighty has chosen thee and purified thee, chosen thee above the women of all nations. Chosen Mary, above the women of all nations. I say, such an honor is not to be found given to Mary, the mother of Jesus, even in the Christian Bible. It continues. Ya Maryam uknuti li rabbiki wasjudi warkai ma'arraqin. Say, O Mary, worship thy Lord devoutly. Prostrate thyself and bow down in prayer with those who bow down. Thalika min amba'i l'ghaybi nuhihi ilayka. This is part of the tidings of the things unseen, which we reveal unto thee, O Apostle, by inspiration. وَمَا كُنْتَ لَدَيْهِمْ إِذْ يُلْقُونَ أَقْلَامَهُمْ So thou wast not with them when they cast lots with arrows as to which of them should be charged with the care of Mary. أَيُّهُمْ يَكْفُلُ مَرْيَمَا وَمَا كُنْتَ لَدَيْهِمْ إِذْ يَخْتَصِمُونَ Nor was thou with them when they disputed the point. The story is that the mother of Mary, she was barren and she prayed to God for a child. Like Zechariah also in his old age, he prayed for a child and John the Baptist was born. This mother of Mary, she also prays for a child and in the mercy of God, she conceived and a child was born. And the child was Mary. She was yearning for a male child, a boy. But instead of a boy, a girl is born. And she had dedicated, she had vowed to dedicate this child for temple services. And the female is in no way like the male. She was disappointed. But what was she to do? She bided her time. When the child was big enough to be handed over to the temple, for looking after the temple, looking after the priests. She takes this little child, Mary, and there was a dispute in the temple. Everybody wanted this beautiful child to be a godfather to this little child. And there was a dispute. Everybody wants a child. So they started casting lots, like what we say, head or tail, like the tossing of the coin. And it came to the turn of Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, that it came to his turn. And there was a dispute among the people. They said, no, you are cheating. You know how we usually do when you lose. You say, you are cheating. There was a dispute.
Now, God Almighty is reminding us through the lips of his holy prophet Muhammad that you were not there. Oh, Muhammad, you were not there when they cast lots with arrows, nor were you there when they disputed the point. Where did you get this information from?
The answer is in the verse itself. These are part of the tidings of the things unseen which we reveal unto thee, O apostle, by inspiration. He is given by inspiration by God Almighty.
But the controversialist, the propagandists, the opponents of Muhammad, the opponents of Islam,
they say, no, Muhammad concocted this. He copied his book from the Jews and the Christians.
He says, this is given to me by inspiration.
They say, no, this is his own handiwork.
For the sake of argument, tonight, I will agree with the enemies of Islam who say Muhammad wrote the book for the sake of argument, knowing full well that this is not his work.
We are assured in the Holy Quran, Allah says, وَمَا يَنْتِكُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ, that he does not speak from his own desire. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ,
it is no less than inspiration sent down to him.
عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَىٰ, he is taught by one mighty in power. Knowing full well that this is an inspiration, revelation from God, for the sake of argument, we will agree with the enemy that Muhammad wrote the book. In return, I'm only asking something very simple, very easy. I want you to agree with me, friend and foe alike, that Muhammad was an Arab. Any difficulty? The only thing I want you to agree with me is that Muhammad was an Arab. That he was not an Indian, he was not an African, he was not a Chinese, he was not an Eskimo. Am I asking too much? No. That Muhammad was an Arab. That's all.
This Arab is telling other Arabs that a Jewess, the mother of Jesus, she was chosen above the women of all nations.
Why would he want to go out of his way and provoke his own people? Why should he do that?
When the Jews were looking down upon their Arab brethren for 3,000 years, they were insinuating that Father Abraham had two wives, Sarah and Hagar, and they are the children of Sarah through Isaac, and the Arabs are the children of Hagar through Ishmael, and as such they are an inferior breed of people, who the Arabs, but they are children of a bond woman, an African woman. You know, they have been racist from the beginning. The very same Jews, they murmured against Moses when he took that Ethiopian wife, it's in the Bible, and God struck Miriam with leprosy, and she was not healed until she repented because of her racism.
The same attitude towards her Arab brethren, that these are the children of bond women. Looked down upon them for 3,000 years, and yet this Arab, Muhammad, may peace and blessings of God be upon him, he is saying that a Jewess, the mother of Jesus, she was chosen above the women of all nations. Not his own mother, or his wife, or his daughter Fatima, whom we Muslims believe will be the leader of the women of paradise. No. Mary, the mother of Jesus, was a woman chosen above the women of all nations. I say, account for that. Account for it. Why should an Arab go out of his way and provoke his own people and honor this Jewess? As some would say, a woman from his opposition, a nation who opposes the Arabs. Why should he do that? Unless he was commanded to say so, to do so, which actually this is what he says. that this is given to me by inspiration. It is not what I want to say or what I feel like saying. This is given to me, and I have no alternative but to give it to you as I receive it, the message. Verse 45, chapter 3, verse 45. It continues.
Excuse me, lady. There will be time for questions. Let the speaker carry on. At the end of the session, we'll give you an opportunity. Please let the speaker carry on.
Chapter 3, verse 45. It continues, the birth of Jesus.
Is qalatil malaikatu ya Maryamu.
So behold, the angel said, O Mary,
inna Allaha yubashiruki bi kalimatin minhu,
that Allah gives you glad tidings, good news of a word from him. Ismuhul Masih, his name will be the Messiah, translated Christ. Ismuhul Masih, Isa ibn Maryama, Jesus the son of Mary, wajihan fi dunya wal akhirah, held in honor in this world and in the hereafter, wa minal muqarrabin, and of the company of those nearest to God. What the Christian would say, sitting on the right hand of God. Many people misunderstand, thinking that God Almighty is sitting on a glorified chair, a throne, and Jesus Christ on another little chair by his side, like a little flea or a molecule. Imagine if God Almighty is sitting on a throne physically, then Jesus, you know, he wouldn't be even a speck. No honor. No. What it means is, in Eastern languages, when we say sitting on my right hand, it doesn't literally mean sitting on my right hand. It's a position of respect. The Quran says that he will be in the company of those nearest to God, not physically, not geographically, spiritually. And he will speak to the people. Fil mahdi wa kahlan, in childhood and in maturity. Wa mina salihin, and he shall be of the company of the righteous. This is a prophecy. The good news is being given that your child, as an infant, he will speak. And as a grown-up, normally, naturally. But as an infant, in childhood, he will be gifted. And we find the fulfillment of this prophecy within months of this good annunciation was being made to her. Within months. And we find this in the Holy Quran in a chapter called Surah Maryam, meaning chapter Mary. This chapter 19 is named in honor of the mother of Jesus Christ. Surah Maryam, chapter Mary. You know, in this whole vast volume, there is no chapter in the name of Muhammad's mother or his wife or his daughter. Can you imagine? But the chapter 19 is in honor of the name of the mother of Jesus. Surah Maryam, chapter 19. It tells us, verse 27, I'm starting, that after the birth of the child, these circumstances being peculiar, she had retired to a remote place in the east. There is no Joseph the carpenter in the Quran. You know Joseph the carpenter? There's no mention about Joseph the carpenter here. This is a miraculous birth, and it speaks about it miraculously. There is no genealogy of Jesus, like we find in the New Testament, in the Gospel of St. Matthew and the Gospel of St. Luke. Between the two, they give this man, mighty messenger of God, 66 fathers and grandfathers. 66. A child that was born miraculously, they go out of the way to give him a genealogy. The Quran does not speak about any genealogy. It does not mention Joseph the carpenter or any other carpenter. So the circumstances of the conception being peculiar was immaculate. She retired to a remote place in the east, says the Quran, and after the birth of the child, she returns. Shamelessly, of course, carrying the little child infant in her arms.
فأتت به قومها تحمله. So at length she brought the babe to her people, carrying him in her arms.
قالوا, they said, يا مريم, O Mary, لقد جئت شيئا فريا.
So truly an amazing thing has thou brought. They are shocked, knowing full well that she was not married.
Where did you bring this child from? The insinuating, illegitimate child. Where did you get this child from? Shamelessly parading in the village.
Ya ukhta Haruna, the old sister of Harun, coming such a noble ancestry of the children of Aaron, the brother of Moses, the Levites, the priestly class among the Jews. You come from such a priestly and noble family.
Ya ukhta Haruna, ma kana abuki imra'a saw'in wa ma kanat ummuki baghiya.
So your father was not a man of evil, nor thy mother a woman unchaste. Insinuating, where did you bring this illegitimate child from? What is she to do?
Would they listen to her explanation? Would you listen to your daughter's explanation? If she tells you, says, Daddy, you know, I heard some voices and now this child is born, you'll believe her. Would you? They were in no mood to listen to such stories. What was she to do? She merely pointed to the babe.
فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ, says the Quran. She merely pointed to the child and says, ask him. She knew that this was no ordinary child. Ask him. So they say, قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ سَبِيًّا. They say, how can we talk to one who's a child in the cradle,
a baby, an infant? How can we talk to him? And by a miracle, he spoke from his mother's arms and defended his mother against an unbelieving audience. He says,
قال إني عبد الله. So most certainly I am the servant of Allah. آتاني الكتاب. He has given me revelation. وجعلني نبيا. And he has made me a prophet.
وجعلني مباركا أينما كنت. وأوصاني بالصلاة والزكاة ما دمت حيا. وبرا بوالدتي. ولم يجعلني جبارا شقيا.
He said, I am indeed a servant of God. He had given me revelation and made me a prophet, and he had made me blessed wheresoever I be. So, and he hath made enjoined on me prayer and charity as long as I live, and he has made me kind to my mother and not overbearing or miserable. He has made me kind to my mother and not overbearing or miserable. This is the first miracle that Jesus Christ performed according to this holy book of Islam. He defended his mother against an unbelieving audience as an infant from his mother's arms.
I want you to compare this first miracle of Jesus with the first miracle that Jesus Christ performed according to the Holy Bible.
You know what miracle he performed? It was at the marriage feast at Cana. You read in the Gospel of St. John that Jesus and his disciples had gone there and they ran short of wine.
So his mother comes to him. This is my son, knowing that he's got that mysterious powers. God had given him powers, spiritual powers, that he can perform miracles. So she comes to him. He says, my child, these people have run short of wine. Help them. Do something for them. So Jesus responds, it's a woman, woman, what have I to do with thee? My time is not yet.
But persuaded, he turns water into wine. And since then, wine has flowed like water in Christendom.
Last year, our beautiful country, our good people spent 2,000 million rand on alcohol. Last year, our good people spent 2,000 million rand on gambling. And yet, you see on TV again and again, some program or the other about spastics, about the cripples, about the blind. They haven't got enough money. We haven't got enough money. The government hasn't got enough money. 2,000 million was squandered on alcohol alone. Last year, in our country.
The first miracle in the Quran
he defends his mother as an infant. The first miracle in the Bible, he turns water into wine.
Going back to the Annunciation, we had reached verse 45, 46, verse 47. When this good news was given to Mary about the birth of a holy son, she says, قَالَتْ رَبِّ أَنَّا يَكُنُوا لِي وَلَدٌ وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٌ. She says, oh my Lord, how shall I have a son when no man has touched me?
So the angel says in reply,
قَالَ كَذَلِكِ اللَّهُ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ.
See, even so, Allah creates what He wills.
وَإِذَا قَضَى أَمْرًا, whenever He decrees a matter, فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولُ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. See, whenever He decrees a matter, He merely says to it, be and it is.
This is the Muslim concept of the birth of Jesus. For God to create a Jesus without a human father, He merely wills it and the thing comes into being.
If He wants to create a million Jesuses without father, without mother, He merely has to will them into being.
This is what we believe about the omnipotence of God in Islam.
I had the occasion of sharing this with the Reverend, the head of the Bible Society in Johannesburg. I had gone to Johannesburg on one of my usual trips, and I went to the Bible house. I was interested in an Indonesian Bible. I have reason for that. So I went and got one there. The Durban Bible house didn't have it, so I go to Johannesburg and I found the Bible in the Indonesian language. And while browsing through the stack, quite a large volume, larger than this, a large volume, New Testament, Greek and English, side by side. Greek and English. So while handling that, I didn't know that I was being observed. The head of the Bible Society walks up to me, seeing my funny headgear and my beard. He was attracted, or he felt that it was a challenge in the Bible house. So he comes up to me and starts a conversation. He said, my interest in such an expensive volume. So I told him I was interested in comparative religion and I had something special that I wanted to look for inside. So he invites me for a cup of tea into his office. I accepted. Very kind of him. So sitting at his table, having tea with him, I started telling him my interest in this subject. That we Muslims, we believe in Jesus. We believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of God. On and on, what I told you at the beginning. And the man seemed to be skeptical. You see, only retired reverends can become heads of Bible societies. He was much older than me then. I don't know whether he's still alive. Reverend Dunkers. He was skeptical, so I started reading to him the Quran in Arabic and giving him the translation.
Beginning, وَإِسْطَانَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ. So behold, the angel said, O Mary, and on and on and on.
By the time I reached this verse, that for God to create, He merely wills it and the thing comes into being, and God will appoint him an apostle to the children of Israel, teaching him the law and the gospel, and that he will give life to the dead by God's permission, and he will heal those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. Reverend Dunkers was elated. He says, you know, this is the same as in my book. What I am reading to him from the Quran, by heart, what I had known, he says, this is the same in my book, in the Bible. I said, yes, on the face of it is the same. But I says, you know, if we analyze it intently, you'll find that the difference between what you have been reading in the Bible and what I'm reading to you is chalk and cheese. You know, this expression, chalk and cheese, the North Americans didn't understand. You see, because they are not used to chalks anymore. They say crayon, crayon. So when you say chalk and cheese, the younger generation never heard the word chalk. Means poles apart, directly opposite one to the other. Chalk and cheese. He said, no, how can you say that? I said, look, I will demonstrate it to you, the difference. On the face of it, If a Christian comes across what I have spoken just now,
written in English without the Arabic text, pieces of paper with these verses that I have quoted to you now, he picks it up, in 1,000 years the Christian will never guess he's reading the Quran, in 1,000 years. If he reads what I have read to you, he will say, perhaps this is the Jehovah's Witness version, if he hasn't seen one. Perhaps it's the Roman Catholic version, if he hasn't seen one. Perhaps it's the New World Translation, and so on and on. The Living Bible, if he hasn't seen one. He'll never guess he's reading the Quran. He's going so close, one with the other.
But I said, when you compare, it's chalk and cheese. I said, what do you see? Where? What do you find? I said, look, when the good news was given to Mary, the mother of Jesus, in the New Testament, in the Bible, she says, how can this thing be when I know not a man, mean physically? I know not a man. In the Quran, she says, قَالَتْ رَبِّ أَنَّا يَكُونُ لِي وَلَدٌ وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٌ. She says, oh my Lord, how can I have a son when no man has touched me? Means the same thing. 100% means the same thing. The only difference is the choice of words. Whether no man has touched me or I know not a man, both meaning physically, sexually. But the replies to these question of hers is revealing. We are told in the Gospel of St. Luke that the angel said, and the Holy Ghost will come upon thee, and the power of the Most High will overshadow thee. I'm only quoting. I am telling the Reverend Dunkers that you are giving a stick to the atheist, the agnostic, the communist to beat you with. Because he will ask you, how did the Holy Ghost come upon Mary? How? How did the Almighty overshadow her? How? We know it doesn't mean that. We know it is metaphorical. But the language is down to earth. Language. Holy Ghost coming upon her and the power of the Most High overshadowing her. In the Holy Quran, the same thing is being spoken. But the language, وَإِذَا قَضَىٰ أَمْرًا, whenever he decrees a matter, فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولُ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ, he merely says to it, be and it is. For God to create, he merely wills it and the thing comes into being. It is not necessary for the Holy Ghost or anybody to come upon Mary or overshadow her. The language. And the eminent Billy Graham, some years ago in King's Park, I was there with my secretary, Mr. Vanker, then. We were there. And he dramatized this birth of Jesus. He said, and the Holy Ghost came and impregnated Mary. This is how he did it. The great Billy Graham impregnated Mary. The Holy Quran says, for God to create, he merely wills it and the thing comes into being. But what does this miraculous birth prove? Does that make him into a god? Or a begotten son of God? We say no. The Quran says, Inna masala Isa indallahi kamasali Adama. He says the similitude of Jesus in the sight of God is like that of Adam. Khalaqahu min turabin. He created him from dust. Thumma qala lahu kun fayakun. And he said, be, and he was. If Jesus becomes God, or the begotten Son of God, because he had no earthly father, then Adam would be a greater God, because he had no father and no mother. This is the argument. If this makes Jesus God, because he had no earthly father, then in that case, whose father was Adam? Who was Adam's father? God. So he is more preeminently God's son than Jesus. This is what the Quran says. And you believe, everybody believes, that Adam was created without a father, without mother. But the Christian missionary, he says, no, you see, Adam was made from the dust of the ground. He was created, but Jesus was begotten. He was begotten by God. And I have been asking learned people, the DDs, the master of theologies, the reverends, I said, excuse me, please, will you please explain to me, when you say begotten, not made, what are you trying to emphasize?
I want you to tell me what you are really trying to tell me. You say begotten, not made. And believe me, in 40 years, I haven't come across a single learned Englishman who had ventured out to explain to me what it means. Not that they don't know.
But it's a horrifying thought. You're trying to articulate begotten, not made. I said, explain what it means. It had to be an American. They have the guts, the Americans. An American. When I posed the question, he said, it means sired by God. I said, what? He said, no, I don't mean that. You ask me what it means. I'm only explaining what it means. It means sired by God.
But Adam was made from the dust of the ground. So I said, look, there is another Superman in your book, the Bible. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 7, book of Hebrews, that is the name of a book in the Holy Bible. Book of Hebrews, chapter 7, it speaks about Melchizedek, the high priest of Salem. Salem, Salam, Islam, the high priest of Salem, to whom Abraham gave tithes, taxes, he paid his zakat to this priest. And Paul tells us that without father, without mother, without beginning, without end, without descent, made like unto the Son of God. No father, no mother, no end, no beginning, no end, and no descent. So I said, tell me now, who can that be except God himself? Only God could have no beginning and no end. Adam had a beginning and he had an end. Jesus had an apparent. He had a beginning in the stable. We are told in the Gospel of St. Luke that when he was 8 days old, he was circumcised and named Jesus by the angel when he was in his mother's womb. So if he was in his mother's womb, that means he had a beginning. And according to the Christians, he gave up the ghost on the cross. So he had an apparent end. This man, Melchizedek, no father, no mother, no descent, no beginning, no end. I said, worship him. The man deserves to be worshipped. But nobody seems to have heard of him. It's an amazing thing. When I show this to the learned men of Christianity, I said, look at this. And they seem to be seeing it for the first time. Never saw it before. I said, it's there. You're reading it. What are you reading? However, I'm asking the reverend, so between these two versions, the one, the Quranic version of the birth of Jesus, and the other, the biblical version of the birth of Jesus, I asked him, which would you prefer to give to your daughter? And he bowed his head in humility, and he said, I would prefer to give the Quranic version. The man was honest. He was humble. I would prefer to give the Quranic version. But people don't want to have access to this book. They don't want to see it. They don't want to touch it. I had some sick people in my office this morning. A pastor of the Pentecostal church this morning in my office. And I'm asking whether he's seen the Quran. He says, no. I said, look, you haven't read the Quran. He says, no, I don't want to touch it. I don't want to see it. I said, look, this book, 1,000 million people in the world today who take this as a book of authority. Even out of curiosity, you ought to see this book. If you want to understand the mentality of these 1,000 million people, common sense demands that you see the book. Common sense. You ought to know what the guy is thinking, what he's talking about. He said, I'll never touch it. He'll never touch it. He said, sick people. Sickness beyond remedy. I said, just from the worldly point of view, look, in our universities, they're teaching our children to analyze Das Kapital by Karl Marx. In the country, the book is banned. Das Kapital by Karl Marx is banned. But in our universities, our students have to study it. They want to know how to give battle to that sickness. If we are sick, the Muslims, if you are sick, if you want to understand our sickness, well, here is the book. It'll tell you why we are sick, what we are talking, and why we are talking the things that we are talking. But if you don't have access to this book, if you don't want to see this book, how will you know? How are you going to give battle to the sickness? No, but it's a sickness. That sickness is a sickness beyond repair.
So what makes our main difference, the main difference between the Muslim and the Christian, is this divinity of Christ. Look, we say he was one of the mightiest messengers of God. He was born miraculously. He gave life to the dead by God's permission. He healed those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. We are going together. The Muslim and the Christian is going together. The parting of the ways is when the Christians say that Jesus Christ is God Almighty who came down to earth as a man. He is God incarnate, God taking human flesh. We Muslims, we say God does not incarnate. He doesn't take human form. This is our battle. So what makes him God? Look, his birth. If it is his birth, then Adam is greater than Jesus. If it is birth, Melchizedek is greater than Jesus. These are all false standards. I agree. You'll agree. These are false standards of judging. But if you bring these standards, false standards, I say, look, according to your own standards, you will lose. You will come out second best. So what makes him God? I was speaking to Reverend Dr. Morris of the Presbyterian Church in Canada, DD. He had come to South Africa on a visit, and I had taken him to the Golden Peacock in Durban. Not Tehran, here in Durban, there's a Golden Peacock, beautiful restaurant. I had taken them for lunch. And at the table, I was telling, I said, look, we believe in Jesus. All these things about this mighty messenger of God. The only real difference is this, the divinity. And for that, I said, look, you have no authority. There is not a single verse in the whole vast volume of the Bible, 66 books. There is not a single verse where you find it unequivocally written, Jesus says, I am God, or where he says, worship me. There isn't. I said, there is nowhere in the Bible where he says, me and the God Almighty are one and the same person. And that tickled his memory. These words of mine tickled his memory. He said, he did. I said, where? Because I said, I am prepared to accept. I know that Jesus will never lie. If he says he is God, I am prepared to accept him as God. If he says worship me, I am prepared to worship him. I don't speak for my brother, and nor my sisters. I speak for myself. Because if there was such a thing, if Jesus made such a claim, I submit unreservedly. Where does he say? He said, no, he did say. I said, what? He said, I and my Father are one. Jesus did say, I and my Father are one. So I'm asking the Reverend Dr. Morris, DD, I said, what is the context? Context. He starts staring at me. The biryani is there. He kept on staring at me. I said, why, sir? Don't you know what is the context? I said, you see, what you quoted is the text. John chapter 10, verse 30. Text. I want the context, the text that goes with it, before or after. What is the context? And the man kept on staring at me, as if he didn't understand English. He is DD. I'm D that. So he said, do you know the context? He's asking me. I said, of course I know the context. So what is the context? I said, well, let us start from John, that same chapter 10, verse 23. So we start. Usually, my Christian brethren, as soon as you ask for something, they have a Bible under the arm, they take it out. I said, no, put that Bible away. You know what you are... Look, if you quoted me a verse, surely you know, man, in what sense he made that utterance. Put the Bible down. He didn't have a Bible, nor did I. So, what is the context? As a John, we start from verse 23. It reads, and Jesus walked in Solomon's porch, meaning in the temple of Jerusalem, alone. I don't know why he was tempting the devil, walking alone. You know, he had condemned them for their formalism, their ceremonialism, the going for the letter of the law, forgetting the spirit. He said, you hypocrites, you generation of vipers, you whited sepulchres, you wicked and adulterous generation. These are all these beautiful epithets he had thrown at them. And
a little while before he had gone into the temple and he made a whip, knotted whip, and he started whipping the people and he upset the money exchanger's tables and upset their money. Shh. Look, when you do things like that, people have it in for you. And the Jews were not in a hurry to forget the manner in which he had condemned them, the way he had treated them. Now he's alone, no disciples with him, alone. He says, so then came the Jews round about him, means surrounded him. Naturally, they got an opportunity of a lifetime. He's able to pluck them out of my hand. Verse 28. We reach verse 28. Verse 29, neither shall any man pluck them out of my Father's hand. Verse 30, I and my Father are one. No man will pluck them out of my hand, neither shall any man pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. In this, to see that once a person has accepted faith, I, as a teacher, I see to it that the man remains in faith, and God Almighty also sees to it that the person remains in faith. I and my Father are one. In this, to see the man doesn't go astray. Where is he talking about? He is God Almighty. He is the omnipotent. He is the omniscient. He is the all-knowing. Where? This is the oneness. Look at the verse 28. Look at verse 29 and say, this is the oneness. But the Jews were looking for trouble. They wanted to get their own back. So they picked up stones again to stone him. So Jesus says, many good works have I showed you from my Father. For which of those works do ye stone me? So they say, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, making kufr. Because that thou being a man makest thyself a God. You are a man and you're claiming to be God. Therefore we want to kill you. We want to stone you. So Jesus says, is it not written in your law? Law, the Hebrew word for law is Torah. In the Old Testament, the five books of Moses, he said, is it not written in your law, I said, ye are gods. He's quoting from the 82nd Psalm, where God says, behold, ye are gods. The Jews, all of you are gods. And all of you are the children of the Most High. 82nd Psalm. He's quoting. He said, is it not written in your law? He's sarcastic. Is it not his law also? Of course it is. But since you are arguing and debating with him, you say, look, in your law, is it not written such and such? And the scripture cannot be broken, meaning you can't contradict me. You can't contradict me what I'm telling you. It's there, man, in your book. Have a look. Say ye of him whom the Father has sanctified and sent into the world, that thou blasphemest, because I said I'm the Son of God. He said, look, it means nothing, man. To say I'm the Son of God means nothing. God has got sons by the tons in the Bible. It's a metaphorical statement. Godly people are called sons of God, and he's got them by the tons. No exaggeration. I'm not exaggerating. By the tons, he's got sons. Metaphorically. God doesn't beget. Metaphorically, we are all his children. Is it not written in your law, such and such? So if even if I said I'm God, according to the Jewish usage, there's nothing wrong with it. But I'm only claiming to be a son of God. But the Jews were looking for trouble, can't you see? And when you're looking for a fight, oh, any excuse will do. Where does he say, I'm God? Where does he say, worship me? So the DD had another idea. He said, you know, in the first chapter of John, chapter 1, verse 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word is Jesus. So he's God. I'm asking, where did Jesus say that he's God, or where did he say, worship me? These are the words of a Jewish philosopher called Philo. Long before Jesus was born, he wrote this in his own book. This, our John, or whoever he was, he plagiarized it. He stole that man's writing, and he put it into the New Testament in his own gospel. Plagiarized it, word for word. But never mind, whatever Philo had in his mind, we won't go into that. I'm asking the reverend, I said, do you know Greek? He said, yes, I did Greek for 5 years before qualification. I said, in that case, you can help me.
I said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. I said, what is the Greek word there for God? And he started staring at me. It seemed as if the game was up. I said, the word there is Houthios in Greek. And Houthios means the God, which you put a capital G, proper noun. You see, the Western nations, they have a system that when you have a common noun, you put a small letter, and when you have a proper noun, you put a capital letter. You know that. Common noun, small letter, proper noun, capital letter. So for the God, it becomes proper, definite article, so they put a capital G. Says, very good, that's your system. But I said, and the word was God. What is the Greek word there for God? No answer. I say, it's tontios, means a God, and for a God means any God, means a godly person. It should have a small G. But I says, you know what? In 2 Corinthians 4:4, in the Bible, it says here, and the devil is the God of this world. The devil is the God of this world. And in Greek, the word is Houthios, the God. I said, why did you give the devil a small G? Why are you grudging him a capital G? So why do you play fast and loose with the book of God? You, whenever it suits you, whatever suits you, you know, you put capital letters where it suits you and small letters where it suits you. God Almighty speaks to Moses and he says, behold, I have made you a God to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. A God to Pharaoh, and you give Moses a small G. Why? For a word, W-O-R-D, word, they put a capital G. But for Moses, they give him a small G in the Bible. So why do you do that? He said, I didn't do it. I said, I know you didn't do it. But I said, the vested interest that you represent, why do you play fast and loose with the book of God? If this is the book of God, why do you play fast and loose with it? This is it. This is our complaint. Why aren't you consistent? Because if you are consistent, perhaps all these problems wouldn't arise between us. Now, the only thing that is left that can make Jesus God, as the Christians say, is that he gave life to the dead. And this is the prerogative of God. Very true. He is still the storm. The Quran doesn't go into any details about his miracles. The only detail is about him speaking as an infant. That's the only detail. The rest is, it tells us that he gave life to the dead by God's permission. He healed those born blind and the lepers by God's permission. He gave life to the dead by God's permission. We accept. But the details, no details in the Quran. The Quran is not a book of stories. It only tells us where there is a difference. It tells us how to come right. So Jesus gave life to the dead. We say by God's permission. But if you take this to confer divinity, there are others in the Bible who perform greater miracles than Jesus. If this is the highest miracle, giving life to the dead, I say it is an impossibility. And because it is an impossibility, if it is done, it's a miracle. A miracle is an impossibility. But I says, you know, a greater impossibility than giving life back to the dead is to take a piece of stick, like Moses did, a piece of stick, a rod, and he turned it into a vegetable kingdom, life, made it into a piece of vegetable. And that vegetable, he made it into a snake, animal kingdom. And this snake went and swallowed up all these snakes of the Egyptians. I said, greater than Jesus, than Elisha. You know, the rotten bones of Elisha, they were burying a man. And when this corpse, this dead body, came into contact with the rotten bones of Elisha, it revived the corpse back to life. Elisha's rotten bones didn't have to say, Thalitha kumi, damsel arise, or Lazarus come out. Didn't have to do that. Just mere touch. This is the Bible, the Holy Bible tells us. The very touch of the rotten bones of Elisha brought the man back to life. Who is greater, I ask you? If these are the standards of judging, these are false standards of judging. Christ told us, He said, for there shall arise many false prophets and false Christs who will show you great signs and wonders if it were possible to deceive the very elect. These are not the tests of a true man or a false man. Even false prophets and false Christs can do miracles. Whereas John the Baptist, the greatest of the Israelite prophets according to Jesus, he said, Jesus said, among those born of women, there has not risen another greater than John the Baptist. And yet John the Baptist performed no miracles whatsoever. These are not the standards of judging greatness or smallness of a messenger of God. But since they insist that Christ gave life back to Lazarus, after 3 days or 4 days, the man was stinking in his grave, and he brought him back from the dead. I said, well, let's analyze it. Who did the works? Who did the job? Did Jesus do it? Did he do it? Did he say he did it? No. We learn from the scriptures, Gospel of St. John. Unfortunately, John is the only one who records this miracle. Imagine, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they have not one word about Lazarus. Not one word about Lazarus. This is the mightiest miracle of Jesus, but Matthew didn't know anything about it. Mark didn't know anything about it. Luke knew nothing about it. All right, let's see what John tells us. He tells us that Lazarus was sick and he died, and Jesus was not there. When he comes to the village, the sisters of Lazarus, Martha and Mary, they tell him, he says, Master, you know, if you were here with us, our brother would not have died. Meaning, if you can heal other people's sicknesses, perhaps my brother's sickness would not have been unto death. So Jesus tells them, assures them, that even now, if you have faith, you will see the glory of God. Not my glory, glory of God. Even now. He says, where have you laid him? Take me. Show me, where have you laid him? So they start taking Jesus to the sepulchre. Not a grave, sepulchre, big roomy chamber. And while walking, he's crying to God. He's praying to God. And the Bible tells us, Jesus wept. Shortest sentence in the Bible, two words. Shortest sentence, you can remember that. Jesus wept. And he groaned in the spirit. What is groaned in the spirit? I'm asking, what is groaned in the spirit? In other words, he was actually communicating with God. The words were inaudible. They couldn't make out. Incoherent. Pouring out a prayer to God. Oh my Lord, my friend, Lazarus, please help him. He's crying and sobbing. The words are not clear enough for the bystanders to listen. So they say he's groaning. Groaning, no groaning. This is his pouring his heart out to God. We do the same. When you're crying out something, the words are not heard properly, but it sounds like a groaning. It's no groaning. It's praying. And God assures him that he'll get what he wants. He wants to bring Lazarus out from the dead. That's his wish. And when he gets the assurance, he says, remove the stone. So they remove the stone. And he lifts up his eyes towards heaven. Now they can hear what he has to say. He said, oh my Father, I know that thou hast heard me. What? That groaning. He was praying to God. I know that thou hast heard me, and I know that thou hearest me always. Everything that I did was on account of you hearing me, listening to, answering my prayers. And I know that thou hearest me always, but because of the people that stood by, these superstitious, credulous people, they will think that I am a god. Because of these people, I said it, I am putting up an act, talking loudly that they may know who's doing the works. And I know that thou hearest me always, but because of the people that stood by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. You are doing the works. He says, it is God who is doing the works. The Quran says, it is God who is doing the works. Peter testifies in the book of Acts to the Jews. He says, ye men of Israel, O Jews, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him. God did by him in the midst of you, which you yourself also know. It's not Jesus. It's not Moses. It's not Muhammad. It's God who's doing the work. Glorify God. And we read in the scripture, when Jesus performed a miracle, somebody rightfully remarked, glory to God for giving such powers unto men. Glory to God. This is the real attitude of a man of God. glorify God, not man. What makes him God? We are told in the Holy Quran to tell the Jews and the Christians on the subject of Jesus. Why are we interfering in this subject? People want to know, why do you want to talk about Jesus? What have you got to do with Christ? I said, we have everything to do with Christ. Look, when Islam came to the forefront, when Muhammad, the prophet of God, declared his mission, he was surrounded by Jews and Christians. And these Jews and Christians, they had certain religious ideas about Jesus. The Jews said that because he's got no earthly father, he's the illegitimate child of Mary. The Christians said because they can't, he's got no earthly father, his father is God. One said he was the illegitimate child of Mary, and the other said he is the son of God. On the same basis that he's got no father. What are we to say? Muhammad claims to be the recipient of a divine revelation, guidance for people, for mankind. So he's made to say, Qul, tell them, Ya Ahlal Kitab, O people of the book, O Jews and Christians, O learned people, you know you claim to have been in possession of a book. Books. You call it the Torah, you call it the Psalms, you call it the New Testament. You are people of learning. La taghlu fi dinikum. He said, do not go to extremes in your religion. Don't go to extremes. Wa la taqulu ala Allahi illa al-haq. And don't say anything about God except the truth. Innamal Masih, most certainly the Messiah, Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus the son of Mary, Rasulullah, is a messenger of Allah. Wa kalimatuhu, and a word proceeding from him. Alqaha ila Maryam wa ruhum minhum, which he bestowed upon Mary, and a spirit proceeding from him. Fa aminu billahi wa rusulihi, so believe in Allah and his messengers. This is what the Muslim is made to say. We have to take a stand, and we are forced now. We haven't done the job. This is what we have been reading. We have possession of this book, this instruction, for 1400 years, but we haven't delivered the message. So the Christian is coming and knocking at our doors. He is telling us, now he is trying to push Christ down our throats, that Christ died for your sin. Now we have to talk to him. Jesus is the only begotten son, begotten, not made. We have to talk to him. Can't you see? Whether you like it or not, there are 35,000 full-time missionaries in Africa at the present moment, raising the dust. 35,000 missionaries, crusaders. Not priests, parsons, or predicants. Missionaries, crusaders. In Pakistan, in Bangladesh, in Indonesia, they are knocking at our doors. You must know where you stand. You shouldn't be like doormats, people coming along and using you as a doormat, using you as a punching bag, making nest in your head, because you don't know. It's about time that you picked up the book and became familiar with your own stand, what does the Quran say, and get familiar with what the man is talking about. Whether you know that when he's quoting you, he said, look, what is the context? Ask him. And you see, the poor man knows nothing. He's only programmed with only certain verses. If you know that amount, look, he can't steal your children. They're stealing your children now. They are going, I'm telling you. We are too lackadaisical, too complacent. We can't afford to lose one. Why should we? Look, this is what you owe to yourself, we owe to ourselves. The Christian owes to himself, he must familiarize with it. If he wants to talk to us, he will be able to talk better. He'll understand our sickness or our health better by knowing our book. He needs a book. And we Muslims, we also have to familiarize. And for that, I have given you these books. Easy study and reference. These little things here. You master this and you mastered it all. You don't have to swallow this whole book, 66 books of the Bible, an encyclopedia. You don't have to swallow that. Nobody, the Christian doesn't know it himself. He doesn't know it. So you don't have to take all that trouble. You take these little pamphlets of mine and man, familiarize yourself with what it says. And I tell you, there is no missionary born who will be able to shake you. You owe it to yourself. And go out and show them. Preach to them. To solve a problem, sitting at home won't do. Allah Bari Ta'ala told us 1400 years ago.
He sent this telegram, and we are still sitting on it like a cobra on these telegrams, addressed to the Jews and the Christians. The Quran says, Qul, tell them, Ya Ahlal Kitab, O people of the book, Ta'alaw, come, Ila kalimatin sawa'im bainana wa bainakum, that we come to common terms as between us and you. Come on, let us get onto a common platform. Call them the Jews and the Christians, let us get onto a common platform. And the terms of getting together, Allah na'buda illallah, that we worship none but Allah, wala nushrika bihi shay'an, and that we associate no partners with him, وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ, and that we do not take from among ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَقُلُوا شَهَدُوا بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ, but if they turn back, tell them that we at least are Muslims. We have submitted our wills to the will of God. Whatever God wants us to do, we are prepared to do. This is the message. We are sitting on it for 1400 years. You don't do the job, then you pay the price. This is it. Our problems are because you're not doing your job. We don't do our job. And it is so easy. Get a translation. How much? 750. Look, there's not another book on earth you can buy for that price. 2,000 pages. Try. Go to the Christian bookshop and see. This one here, this Bible, I paid 14 rands. 100% more than that. For this. I show another book just now. I paid 30 rands from the Christian Bible, Christian bookshop. This one, 2,000 pages, 7 rands 50. And if you can't afford it, I say, you get it free. What excuse have you got? On the day of judgment, I can stand before the Lord and say, oh my Lord, I tried to help my brothers and sisters. I offered them your book absolutely free to those who couldn't afford, and yet they couldn't take advantage. Those who can afford, no reason to be one without it. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, the subject is vast. 15 different chapters speak about this mighty messenger of God. One is not expected to wade through 15 chapters. 25 different places is mentioned by name. One is not expected to wade through it all. I have given you the gist of our message, Christ in Islam. And now I leave myself open to you. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallah. Thank you, Mr. Didat. I just want to recall the objectives I had set out when I opened this discussion. And I said that I trust that at the end of this session, we hope that a proper perspective would be brought into this topic, and that is that Jesus Christ, Nabi Isa alayhi salam, is revered and respected by Muslims. And this is not what Mr. Didat has to say, but what the Quran has to say in volumes. Also, that Muslims are not anti-Christ, as is the present slogan of many, and that this subject is too vast to cover in one lecture. Before I call discussion for questions, I just want to remind the audience about another verse of the Quran which extends this topic so vastly. It says, say, we believe in Allah and in what has been revealed to us, and what was revealed to Abraham, Ismail, Isaac, Yaqub, and the tribes, and in the books given to Moses, Jesus, and the prophets from their Lord. We make no distinction between one another among them, and to God we do bow our will to Islam. The other objective I had set out was the significance to this to Muslims. It is absolutely essential that if anybody, Muslims alone, have to take the cudgels and pass the message on, as Mr. Didat is attempting to do. Brothers, when we all entered this hall, we heard a tape in the form of a poem. This was a poem by Yusuf Islam, formerly known as Cat Stevens, also formerly of the Christian faith and now a Muslim. And this tape is available at the Islamic Propagation Center and at the Islamic Book Service. At the end of this session, there will be literature available. There will be tapes available from tomorrow at the offices of the Propagation Center and the Islamic Bookshop, together with videotapes. I now come to an important aspect of tonight's session, and that is questions and answers. However, when one comes to this part, it is absolutely essential that we discipline ourselves, for time is not in our favor. We have half an hour. We would love to accommodate everyone, but unfortunately, time is at a premium and we cannot allow this. Those who are keen to ask questions are welcome to come to the mic in front. If they could take their position here and put the questions to the speaker. For the benefit of all, let us stick to the topic, let us be to the point, and let us get on with as many questions as we have. I call upon any person who wishes to ask any questions. Good evening. If you could address your question to me, and then I will put it on to Mr. Dirac, please.
Not done. Oh, good, thank you. Mr. Lockhart, as you finished off, you quoted from the Quran saying that you Muslims believed essentially all the revelations of the past prophets, quoting from Abraham right through.
Right.
Right. And it's in that context that I wish to ask a question referring to Jesus, yes, from that point of view.
Right.
Okay. Now, I have in my hand a book called The Holy Scriptures, published by the Jewish Publication Society. The point I want to make is, it's not a pro-Christian publication. It is the Jewish authentic scriptures, right? In fact, it has been authenticated by God himself, in as much as the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were discovered by a Muslim. And I think in that there is a very pertinent message to Muslims, authenticating the very scriptures that Jesus said, I do not come to do away with the law and the prophets, I come to fulfill them. And Mr. Didad, you yourself said, if Jesus was here, if it was possible you see in person, he told you something, you would accept him because you knew he would not tell a lie. Right. So, in other words, I want to...
Can you just ask the question?
I will do.
Please.
I want to give the background because it's very important. I want to quote from the book of Isaiah, because it is one of the many scrolls that was preserved in the Dead Sea Scrolls intact. It hasn't been tampered with for 2,000 years. This is the point I want to make. It's authentic. It's original. Let's start at a point of
agreement. Sorry to disturb you. You want to make some comments. You don't have a question for the speaker.
I do.
Please, if we can get down to the question, I think it will make things much easier. Ask your question. Let the speaker answer it. Let's be fair to you as well.
Are we having troubles here?
Yes, everyone will get a chance. Everyone will get a chance. We're waiting for the question.
Right.
That is all. It's as simple as that.
Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 says, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a young woman, Alma, which can be also translated virgin, will give birth to a son. Now the Quran and the Bible both agree this is Jesus. And his name shall be Emmanuel, which translated means God with us. Just bear that in mind. We turn the page to Isaiah chapter 9 and verse... Yeah, it's coming.
All right. We'll give you a chance. Carry on. We'll give you a chance. Carry on.
I thought that this was a goodwill meeting.
Right.
For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name is Pele Joaz El Geboa Abi Ad Sa Shalom. And at the bottom there's a note here. That is, wonderful in counsel is God mighty, the everlasting father. This little child, this little boy is going to be the everlasting father. We turn the page for one last quotation, then comes the question, and I thank you for your patience. In Isaiah 53, we read these words. And their iniquities did he bear, he bore their sins. Because he bared his soul unto death, he was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sins of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Mr. Didier, you asked the question, where did the Christians get the idea that Jesus was God, which is what we mean when he said he was begotten, he was God that came in the form of a man. Now, my question is this, the Jews themselves are expecting God in the form of a man as their Messiah. Why then does the Quran, which claims to have its roots in this very book, preach a different Jesus? That's my question.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, let me correct my brother Spate. The Jews were not expecting the Messiah as a man-god. They had no such idea. The word Messiah, I gave you an idea that this is a very common word used in the scriptures. I gave you from the very book that you were quoting just now, from the book of Isaiah. I said that Isaiah chapter 45, verse 1, Cyrus, a pagan, a polytheist, an idol worshiper, God Almighty calls him Messiah. If he calls a pagan an idol worshiper, which is the greatest sin to these monotheistic religions like Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, is to associate any beings with God. This Cyrus was a pagan and idol worshiper, and God calls him Messiah. And he says, I have surnamed thee, though thou hast not known me. You, a pagan, you don't know me, but I still surname you Christ. So a pagan can be Christ, and pillars can be Christ. In your book, you want me to give you references? Pillars. Pillars are anointed. Are they made into Messiah? Pillars. Pots and pans. I gave you reference of pots and pans in the book that's given to you. All the text is given. Pots and pans are anointed. Anointed in Greek, Christos, which is Christ. In Hebrew, Messiah. Pots and pans. Pot, Christ. Pillar, Christ. Priest, Christ. It's all in your book. Then you're quoting me about this prophecy about Emmanuel, which means God with us. This is a name. Emmanuel means God with us. And he shall be called Emmanuel. I am asking learned men of Christianity, who called Jesus Emmanuel? In all his 33 years, give me one reference. Who called him Emmanuel at any time? Who called him Almighty God? Who? Who called him so? Nobody. Did he say, I'm God? Did he say, worship me? On the contrary, he says, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is righteous, because I seek not my own will, but the will of him that sent me. He says, see, the word ye hear are not mine, but the Father that sent me. He had given me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak, even as the Father had said unto me, so I speak. He says, of that day knoweth no man, no, not the angels, nor the Son, but the Father in heaven. In what way is he claiming equality with God? Where does he say, I am God? Where does he say, worship me? There isn't. I'm saying, where did he say such words? Nowhere. To the contrary, he's saying, my Father is greater than I. My Father is greater than all. I don't know whether it means what he says. If anybody called him God, called him Jehovah, Emmanuel is nothing. This is the name. You have Emmanuel Cathedral behind your chemist. Emmanuel Cathedral. You see, you have thousands of people in the book. You find hundreds there. Eli. In the Holy Bible. Eli, Eli, Eli. You remember Jesus on the cross is supposed to have cried out, Eli, Eli. You know how many Eli's are there in this book here? Jews. Eli's, how many? Dozens of them. Eli's means my God. The name is my God. If your name is Eli, you know what it means, my God. Am I saying you are my God? Look, here in the book, how many Eli's have you got? Eli. And yet, Jesus is saying Eli, Eli, calling to those Jews as his God. No, these are names in language. Emmanuel means a person who is a godly person, who is ever thinking that God is ever with him in his behavior. That is what it means. It doesn't mean he is God. The Jews didn't have any idea of God's incarnate, the God coming to earth as a man. Messiah means the anointed one, the appointed one. That's all. He was appointed by God to be his representative, to bring them back to the path. The Muslims are telling the very same thing. So look, this man is not God. He is a Messiah, yes. But what does Messiah mean? Go to the root. The root word means anointed, means appointed, officially appointed by God. That is all. And every prophet, you know, some of these terms we take. and we give it specifically, exclusively for certain persons. Every prophet of God is an anointed of God, in Hebrew Messiah. But we use this term exclusively for Jesus. The word Rasulullah, messenger of God. In the Quran, Moses is described as Rasulullah, messenger of God. Jesus is described as Rasulullah, messenger of God. But ask any Muslim, when he says Rasulullah, who is he talking about? He's talking about the Holy Prophet Muhammad. He says, what about Moses? The Quran says Rasulullah. No, this word is exclusively used in that sense for Muhammad. Though Moses is the messenger of God, Jesus is also the messenger of God. We say Abraham is a friend of God. Are all the other prophets his enemies of God? No, but exclusively we reserve that term for Abraham. Moses is an interlocutor with God, one who spoke with God. Didn't Jesus speak with God? Didn't Muhammad speak with God? But we use that term exclusively for Moses, that he spoke with God, though all prophets spoke to him. Likewise, this word Messiah, every prophet of God is a Messiah, is anointed, appointed, consecrated. But we use this term exclusively for Jesus. I don't see anywhere where this man says, I'm God, or where he says, worship me. This is what I want.
Thank you, Mr. Didat. The next speaker, the next questioner.
No, praise God. Can I say salam? Peace be unto you all.
Thank you.
It is true, we've heard good words tonight. We've heard about the birth of the Lord. It has been acknowledged as being miraculous. We've heard of his works. I dispute the fact that a babe spake miraculously to safeguard his mother, because God was with her as well as with the child. We find that according to Eastern chronology, people from the East came to see. If we don't believe in our history, where children were slaughtered by Herod, so that this man-child that was born to be king could have been slaughtered, yet we find that Eastern people, who were clever in their days, as are today, acknowledge the fact, where is he who was born to be king of the Jews? Mr. Didat, in the Quran, you have spoken to us a bit tonight about the birth, the conception, the life, his works, but you didn't touch on the crucifixion. You have glossed over it. You've spoken and mentioned it, but you didn't come to the point. Now, in the Quran says there by Abdul Yusuf Ali, he says there in the commentary of the Quran, to safeguard the Jews, because one is born of the bond and one is born of the free, one of Ishmael, one of Hagar, one of Isaac, God has blessed both. But being brothers in that degree, the Quran says we don't want to put a stigma upon the Jews. So we will say that instead of Christ being crucified, they took another person, they hid the Lord, they hid the anointed. Was he anointed for nothing? Did he have no powers to go forth unto even unto death? That the Jews now, or whoever it was, the Romans or whoever, that the Quran must now say, no, we'll hide this man now. We don't want a stigma to be put on the Jews. And somebody else was handed over to be crucified. God does not lie. Does Muhammad lie? Is the commentator a liar? God is not a man that he should repent, neither the son of man that he should repent. He cannot lie. So why does the Quran now twist that concerning the crucifixion of Christ? You believe in the prophets. You believe in the Psalms. You believe in the Torah. And they all speak of the crucifixion of this one. They all, Isaiah, he was marred like no man was marred. We turned our faces away from him. We despised him. We all. But he still fulfilled the work of God. Thomas said, my Lord and my God. Why does the Quran deny to the facts of the crucifixion of Christ?
Thank you. I think that question is valid. Mr. Didat should answer that. Thank you.
The question, in case you haven't heard it clear enough, coming succinctly to this, that why does the Quran deny the crucifixion? When, as our brother says, that the whole Bible speaks about it. Now, this subject of crucifixion, I have dealt with here from this very platform under the heading, Was Christ Crucified? You remember Brother Spade. Now, here is a witness here, one of our brethren. He will be able to confirm that that subject also takes about an hour.
Not necessarily.
That subject takes an hour to expound.
Not necessarily.
I can make sweeping generalizations to say, I say, we believe that Christ was not killed nor was he crucified. And I quote you a verse from the Quran, وَمَا كَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ. They didn't kill him and they didn't crucify him. Right. But now that doesn't prove anything. For the Muslims, it is proof enough. You see that his Lord says that Christ was not killed and he wasn't crucified. But for you now, you have a record. You say Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and the scriptures as a whole. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the whole Bible. What does the Quran say? Yeah, what does it say? Yeah, what does it say? Yes. From your Bible. No, no, look. I made reference to you.
Moses died, his grave is with us. Jesus died and is in heaven.
I didn't, that words are not there.
He is in this book.
You sit down and you. No, no, no. Look. No, no, you see, this is a false allegation made against me. The steps is here. You sit down there where I say Jesus died. Please find that. In the meantime, give somebody else a chance. Right. Brother. Give somebody else a chance while you find where I say that Jesus died. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Questioner. Thank you, Mr. Questioner. Thank you, sir. Next question, please. Thank you.
Mr. Didat, I really appreciate your presence with us this afternoon. What I would like to stress to you is that earlier on you have mentioned that Melchizedek in the Old Testament had a beginning and the ending like the way the book of Hebrews has been written. And I do appreciate you telling us that Jesus also had a beginning and he also had an ending. But nowhere in the Bible is being mentioned him saying that he is God, O Almighty. I would point out to you a scripture in the very last book of the Bible, which is Revelation chapter 1, verse 8. He says there, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, say the Lord Almighty. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you very much. There is no question there.
I said, and I repeat, that nowhere in the Bible Jesus Christ says, I am God, or where he says, worship me. Our brother has given a quotation from the book of Revelation. That is the last book of the New Testament. The title of the book is the book of Revelation. What is this book all about? It is about a dream. This was a dream. While Jesus walked this earth, according to the canonical gospels, not one statement he made, I am Alpha and I am Omega. Nowhere. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. Nowhere. This is the last book of the New Testament, which was a dream that John had, or whoever he was, he had a dream. And in that dream, if I read it to you, you know, about an animal having seven horns and seven horns with seven eyes. And look, this is a man who is dreaming. Usually a man, when he eats too much, he has dreams like that. You see, this is the human mind. You see how it works. Look, the psychologist will tell you that the human mind is divided into different compartments. We have certain portions of our brain which deals with vision, When it gets damaged, your vision is affected. Certain portion, your hearing is affected. Certain portion, your speech is affected. Certain portions, your imagination is affected. These are different portions in the brain doing different functions, performing different functions. In our dreams, every portion is independent. While we are here, while we are consciously awake, there are things that we want to do and we want to say, but we are thinking, what will people think? This is human beings. We are thinking, say, what will this man think of me? I want to shout. I say, what will people say? This guy has gone hot under the collar. So you see, so many factors. The reasoning faculty is controlling your emotions, controlling every other function. But in your dream, my dream, anybody's dream, everybody's dream. In our dreams, our imagination runs riot. You know, there are things that you do in your dream which you'll never imagine doing it in your waking life. Your waking moments, you'll never do things what you dream about. You know that. I don't know. I'm sure you all will confirm. This is what happens to me, to you, to everybody. So this man, John, is writing a dream. And in the dream, what he saw, and the descriptions, you know, the descriptions that are given, you can see it's only in your dream you can dream like that. You can talk like that. Where Jesus says, while he's walking life, he told anybody, I'm God. Or where he told anybody, worship me. Show me one verse. Yes, my son.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Didak, in the speech you have made, you mentioned that in Islamic religion, you believe that Jesus is the Messiah, and is the messenger of God. And I would go further and say, if you believe that, do you, in Islamic religion, also believe the words of Jesus?
Thank you.
I have some question if you have answered that. Richard.
Oh, this is just the beginning.
Yes, it's a beginning.
The question was whether I believe in the words that Jesus uttered. I do. I do believe.
Thank you. I now go further. If you do believe in the true sense in the words of Jesus, somewhere Jesus says, I and my Father are one. And to my understanding, if you say something is one, it means that particular something is inseparable. Now, I do not understand what makes you to be, what makes you not accept that Jesus is God. If it comes into quality, if you believe that Jesus and God are one, then logically and to my understanding, you should also accept that in quality with God is also one. You do not have to put some separations.
So the question is, you know, that expression, I and my Father are one, I have dealt with it quite extensively. But our brother has the understanding that one means inseparable. It becomes like a sausage, one piece. Now, if that is the case, I'm quoting you the same John. Same John, chapter 17. If you have a Bible, if not, I give this Bible to you. John chapter 17, verses 20 to 22. I'll read it for you, and if I'm misreading or misquoting, you can correct me. The same John who spoke about I and my Father are one, now he says that Jesus told his disciples that they all his disciples, may be one, O-N-E, one. Am I reading correctly?
Yes.
Yes. That they all, you know, those who deserted him, one of them sold him for 30 miserable pieces of silver. The other one cursed, abused, and swore him. They all left him in the lurch when he was most in need. They all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. You know, Judas, Peter, Thomas, the doubting Thomas, you know, yes. The traitor Judas, and the satanic Peter, according to Jesus, he says, get thee behind me, Satan. He told Peter, you remember? You, Satan, he says, get behind me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. That Peter and all the other nine, that they all may be one in us, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, one sausage. Can you imagine? Inseparable. Peter, the doubting Thomas, and Jesus, and God, all become inseparable. So they all become God, one God. You say inseparable means you become a sausage. You make a sausage out of Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and the 12 disciples all become one sausage. Become like a totem pole for us to worship. God, inseparable. No, my brother, my son, no. It doesn't mean that. You see, the oneness is the oneness I explained. It is the oneness of purpose. The purpose of God is to see that a man goes straight. The purpose of the prophet of God is to see that you go straight. And every right-thinking person, every man, every woman, our purpose should be one. But that doesn't make us gods or sausage with gods or become inseparable with God.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have another question.
Mr. Didak, I only want to ask you one question on what you said. Did you read, there's two questions actually. Did you read the Bible properly? That's my first question.
Your first question is, did Mr. Didat read the Bible properly?
Yes.
Thank you. And the second?
When he answers that, I'll ask him the second one.
All right, Mr. Didat, please. Okay, he'll answer your first question. Thank you.
In all humility, I can only claim in humility that I think I did read the Bible properly.
I believe you didn't read the Holy Bible properly, because I want to tell you something from what you told just now. When Jesus came back from the resurrection, he went for the Last Supper, and he said, this is my body and this is my blood. I want to tell you, he had the Last Supper before he was crucified.
Thank you.
Do you agree or do you not? Why do you try and get Jesus into the picture every time, even when you haven't read the Bible properly?
Okay, thank you. Mr. Didat will take those comments. Thank you. There seems to be two more questions. Gentlemen, are you also asking a question? Three more. We'll close with these last three questions. Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask Mr. Didat whether he believes the Bible is God's word. Do you believe that the Bible is God's word?
Is the Bible God's word? Thank you.
You see, this is not a time for joking, but if we had the time, I would have given you a Bible in your hand and asked you whether you believe that Bible to be the Word of God. You see, this subject about the Bible will be discussed in this very city hall on the 13th of December under the heading, Is the Bible God's Word? A symposium is supposed to have taken place here in October between a Christian missionary and my secretary. But for some reason, the Christian missionary has backed out. But my secretary is going ahead with that meeting on the 13th of December in this city hall. He will be expounding fully the subject, Is the Bible God's Word? And then you will have ample opportunity of firing him with questions.
My question tonight is, if he was given the Gospels which the Quran tells us to believe in, then all I can say is he didn't speak Greek, he did not speak English, so how sure am I that the Gospels that I hear are the Gospels of Jesus? That is my question.
Thank you.
The question seems something like this, if I got it right, that the Quran speaks about Jesus preaching the Injil, Evangel, the good news, Injil, in Arabic, Injil. Now, how are we to know? Because we know that Jesus didn't speak English. We have the English Bible, and we have the Afrikaans and the Zulu Bible and all that. What did he preach that we Muslims can say, this is the preaching of Jesus? Now, we believe in the principle that Jesus, God Almighty, gave Jesus Christ a revelation, which we call the Injil, translated gospel. And we read in the Christian Bible that Jesus went to a certain place and he preached the gospel. He went to another place and he preached the gospel. And he went somewhere else and he preached the gospel. Now, when he speaks about gospel, 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 Jesus went and preached the gospel. I can't imagine him carrying a book under his arm and reading out of that as the gospel. So the message that he delivered, we say that message is the gospel, the good news. Unfortunately, the Christians have not been able to preserve that. You see, we have in this book, books in what is called the New Testament. The gospel according to St. Matthew, the gospel according to St. Mark, the gospel according to St. Luke, the gospel according to St. John, and then you have Peter and Paul, and you have James, and you have so many others, all writing what is called the New Testament. But out of these 27 books of the New Testament, there is not one, the gospel according to St. Jesus. This is the sad part. There isn't. So where is this gospel? You bring that gospel and we will see whether we can confirm it with the Quran. I'm sure it won't be anything different from the Quran. If you bring me the gospel that Jesus preached, I'm sure he didn't have one under his arm. The one he preached, the gospel according to Saint Jesus. That is the gospel I believe in. You see? So I'm waiting for somebody to come along out of the Dead Sea Scrolls they're talking about. Maybe one day they'll find one. The gospel according to Saint Jesus. I'll be very happy to read that and show how close it is to the Quran.
Thank you, Mr. Didat. Gentlemen and gentleladies, on the 13th of December, there is going to be a symposium in this city hall. All of you are invited. And finally, I want to thank you one and all for the very able manner in which you behaved this evening. And we pray that God Almighty accepts your effort and the efforts of Mr. Didat in this message of his. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.